building, sharpening your emotional intelligence. Just to recap, I'll give you a little bit of the background of emotional intelligence, even though most of you may be aware of it. The concept came in about 30 years back when we understood that the age-old, 100-year-old concept of IQ, that is the intelligence quotient, used to measure the cognitive intelligence or the logical working of the brain. That is not a parameter or a deciding factor about success and achievement in life. So people started questioning those with very high IQ, why is it that many a time they don't do well in life? And vice versa, those with very low IQ also managed to become very successful people. So the first thing that happened was when Howard Gardner, who was in Bangalore also recently, as you know, very well known, one of the most renowned psychologists in the world today and from Harvard University. Howard Gardner came out with the concept of multiple intelligences. That means your intelligence is not restricted only to the cognitive intelligence of being able to spell correctly or write correctly or calculate numbers correctly, which is what basically the IQ tests do. So he came out starting with 7 different intelligences, and more have been added to that. So you may have a child who has tremendous, let us say, rhythmic intelligence or spatial intelligence, because of which he may become a very good musician or artist or something. And as you know, in the 21st century, a competent artist or an excellent musician can earn much more than a mediocre engineer or other professional. So with all these new avenues and all these things coming up, the multiple intelligences started gathering strength. Another 10 years later, Daniel Goleman came out with the concept, not that it was new, but he brought it down to the masses, of this concept called emotional intelligence, which primarily means how to understand, acknowledge, accept, manage your own emotions and other people's emotions. So if you can understand that and master that skill, you can do a lot of wonders in this world. And that also brought a very great awakening, whereby today people say that 80% of the success, fulfillment and happiness, joy of a human being, 80% of it depends on how good his EQ is. Maybe 20% depends on his IQ. And even that 20% will keep reducing as technology advances and more skills are going to be taken over by machines and computers and robots. 30 years back, you had to sit with a piece of paper and pencil and calculate, you know, doing your multiplication, divisions and numbers and this and that. Even in banks and financial institutions, they had to actually sit with a ledger and keep on totaling item by item and checking whether the totals are correct and physically verifying, etc. Today, all that has been wiped out. It is done in seconds. By the time the day's transactions are over, the computer itself is giving you the trial balance or the day transactions or whatever you want. Same thing is going to happen in every aspect. So that is how we understand that emotional intelligence is going to be the need of the 21st century. The various definitions of emotional intelligence. It could be that it is the innate potential or the capability of a person to feel, use, communicate, recognize, remember, describe, identify, learn from, manage, and understand and explain emotions. So every aspect to do with emotions is what emotional intelligence is all about. Here I also want to clarify one misnomer. People think that being emotional is emotional intelligence. It is not. It is in fact the reverse of that. This I learned 20 years back when I first started working with the military, and I was talking to them about emotional intelligence and the need to take some workshops in that. And there was a general who had a very hearty laugh and he said, Dr. Ali, you are not familiar with the style of the military. Let me tell you that if the superior writes in the confidential record of an officer that he is a very emotional person. That is the end of his career. He will never be given a command. And you are going to teach emotional things to people. I said, yes. Because when the superior writes, this person is emotional, without realizing what he is actually writing is, this person's EQ is low. That is why he gets emotional. Where he does not have to use emotions, he uses it in the wrong way. And that is why you don't want to, you know, entrust him with responsibility or whatever that it is. Whereas, if that same person builds his emotional intelligence and sharpens it further, then he will not be emotional. He will be able to handle very, very difficult emotional situations, and that is what we are looking at. The other aspect I want all of us to know is that unlike IQ, which is primarily through the genes, inherited through whatever we have, EQ can be enhanced at any age. Of course, the earlier the better. Like any skill, if you were 5 years old when you learned cycling, you learned it very fast. If you were 18 years old, it took you a little longer. If you are 80 years old and you want to learn cycling, you can still learn, but it may take you a little more time, and 2-3 times you may end up in hospital with broken bones, but you can still learn. So the fact remains that this is a skill which can be learned. And that is what I am trying to emphasize on today. How do we sharpen our emotional intelligence and then in turn help others or children or whatever your area of concern is. How to help others also to sharpen their emotional intelligence. So that being the good news, we can start working on the aspect of emotional intelligence. Starting with one more very important area. That if you are going to build your emotional intelligence, you should also start practicing and actually, you know, becoming part of what we refer to as emotional honesty. Because if you are not emotionally honest, you will probably not succeed in sharpening your emotional intelligence. What do we mean by emotional honesty? What I mean primarily is to accept my own emotions and not be a hypocrite to my own self. If I am, putting down a colleague of mine or something of that sort, or chiding him for not doing work correctly, do I have the emotional honesty to say somewhere deep down I am feeling jealous? And that is the reason why I am doing this. If I am interacting with someone, do I have the emotional honesty to say, I am feeling insecure somewhere deep down inside, and that is why I am clinging on to this person or whatever it is. So many a time you will find that it is emotional dishonesty which prevents us from developing our emotional intelligence or our EQ. So please, before you even start this process, ask yourself, do you have the habit and the practice of being emotionally honest to yourself? You don't have to admit to anybody else, but to your own self, you have to have that ability to say, yes, I know somewhere deep down inside I'm doing it because I'm feeling jealous, because I'm feeling possessive, because I'm feeling insecure, whatever may be the reason, which again takes a whole circle and comes back to the main point, that is, am I even aware of what I am feeling? So that's where the emotional intelligence starts off with. The five pillars of emotional intelligence which most experts agree upon are, number one, self-awareness. Being aware of what I am, what my indoctrination is, what sort of a person I am, you know, why I have certain values, why I like something or dislike something. Coming down to, what do I feel right now? Am I aware that right now I am feeling depressed, or I am feeling angry, or I am feeling whatever I am feeling? So that self-awareness from the deep down aspect of what I am to what I am feeling right now. The second pillar is to be able to manage those emotions. And when I say manage emotions, it's not just restricted. That's another myth. People think that, If you can manage your anger or your jealousy, everything else can be managed. So we have this habit of labeling some of these emotions as negative emotions and saying, if you can manage anger, if you can manage jealousy, then everything will be fine. No. Sometimes it can be the other way around also. For example, I cannot manage joy. I was trying for a number of years to buy a new car. And today I have purchased that car. Now if my emotional intelligence is not good enough, the second pillar, I don't know how to manage my emotions. I am extremely thrilled, joyful, happy because I have this car. What do I do? I walk into my office and start giving a lecture to everybody whom I meet, saying that, you know, I bought a new car. It's a brand new one, you know, not second hand car. And you know, I paid 10,000 rupees extra for that metallic color. And you know, you've got a music system which is not two speakers, it is four speakers. It's quadraphonic. That's the latest thing which has come now. I paid 32,000 rupees for that. And you know, I got specially designed seat covers made. They are of leather, pure leather seat covers. Now, why am I doing all this? Because my joy, my thrill and this and that is so much that it is bubbling out. But do you realize the consequences of it? Someone else, let's say, who cannot afford a car will look at me and say, why is this person going on and on? Does he want to tell me that you are a good-for-nothing fellow and you can't buy a car? Is this what he is trying to tell me? Even though my intention is not, but you see how I can spoil a relationship just because I do not manage your... So the so-called positive emotion like happiness, joy, thrill, etc. also need to be managed in the correct way. If we don't know how to manage emotion, then we are going to be in deep trouble. And this is another skill which can be developed and learned. The third one is motivation. If you are motivated, if you actually feel what you are doing is worthwhile and you want to do it, life can be such a great pleasure. There are proverbs like, you know, make your vocation into a vacation. Or take a full-time homemaker who doesn't go to any office and work, who doesn't get any salary. There are homemakers who say, I love to go into my kitchen and prepare the type of dishes which I am good at and feed it to my family members. It gives me so much joy. And there are homemakers who get up in the morning, look, give one dirty look to the kitchen door and say, oh my God, again I have to cook today for this stupid family which has no appreciation of what all I have do. What I want you to understand is, while people may use that as an excuse, the second homemaker may tell you, I am motivated, I do want to cook, and I actually used to enjoy cooking once upon a time. But because of the way these people behave, I have lost my motivation. Now this is a myth. Motivation comes from within, not from outside. People may say anything, the motivated person actually takes it as a challenge. There's a beautiful example given about this thing called the bumblebee. The bumblebee is a huge, fat, round, shapeless insect. Not a nice shape, yes, very shapely. Okay, yeah. And it has tiny wings, very, very tiny wings. Now, aeronautical sciences from the time of the Wright brothers in the last 110 years has progressed tremendously. We have now have supersonic aircraft, we have aircraft going to the moon and Mars, we have all sorts of things. And enough research has been done on aerospace and aerosciences. You ask any aerospace engineer that I will make mechanically a gadget, an object which has got this shape and this weight of a bumblebee, and which has got these wings of this size, which can flutter like this. Aerodynamically, will this object be able to fly? They will do all the calculations and tell you, this object will never fly. The weight is too much as compared to this. The wingspan is too small compared to what it should be. The airlift that is accrued by flapping of those wings does not give enough levitation for the object to rise above. So they will give you perfect calculations and perfect logic that this object cannot fly. The only problem is that the bumblebee has never heard of aeroscience. So it flies. Now that is what I think can be taken as a perfect example of motivation. I have to fly, I want to fly, I will fly, and the bumblebee flies. Similarly, in human terms, there are enough instances to show where people who are highly motivated achieve things which are not normally possible. And this is also used as a psychological tool for, let's say, Olympic champions and things of that sort. If I am going to enter into the Olympics, but I am not as good as the gold medal winner in that 100 meter dash, the record is, let's say, 9 seconds. And the best that I have been able to do is only 9.5 seconds or something. So there are these sports psychologists who go on and on and on motivating, encouraging, literally brainwashing me into believing that I can do it in 8.9 seconds. And the funny part is that if I believe it, there is a certain chance at least that I will be able to do it. If I don't believe it, there is a 0% chance that I will be able to do it. So that is the power of motivation. What I keep repeatedly reminding, that the mind plays a very important role on the body. So even though your body may have limitations, who is there to measure the limitation? Who says that this human being can run only in 9.5 seconds or in 8.9 seconds? It is the mind which says the thing finally. So when the mind says that yes, this person can do this, there is a possibility that it can be done. That is the importance of motivation. So these three pillars or parameters that I gave you have to do with yourself. Self-awareness, management of the self and of one's emotions, and building up your motivation, even understanding what motivates you from time to time. Many of us have even forgotten what motivates us. Will we hit a burnout or something of that sort? Who was giving us an example in Mantarna? I think Ashu. About how you had a 20,000 rupee loan and you went to many ways thinking that, at that time, the example that she gave was, here is this young couple who are married and who want to make a good life, and they realize that they have certain debts or whatever it is. And they decide that even if we have to make a sacrifice of leaving our country and going to a strange place and working very hard over there, we'll do it because we don't want to live with a debt which we cannot otherwise repay because the amount is so much and the earning is so less. So it's a great motivator which makes that person go all the way to a new country, struggle it out, go through hardships and achieve that goal. But as Ashu was telling, 20 years later, the person is still chasing that rainbow without realizing that that motivator is no longer applicable to me. Now I need to have a different motivator and then I decide what is my path. So many a time, we start off with the right motivators, but we forget that motivators change. What motivated you when you wanted your first job cannot motivate you 10 years later when you are changing a job. What motivated you to take care of your child when your child was 3 years old cannot motivate you to take care of your child when he is 30 years old. So like that, things keep changing. Then we move on to the other two parameters, which is to do with other people. Because as I keep reminding you, basically a good mental health or a good quality of life is peace within yourself and harmony with others. So peace within myself is to be able to know who I am, what I am, what my aims and goals are. Going right up to the topmost level of what Maslow's hierarchy of needs says, aiming towards some sort of self-actualization to say that, yes, if God brought me into this world and if I was bestowed and blessed with life, and whatever else I got in terms of good house, good parenting, education, good health, whatever it is, I have done justice to it. I have lived a life to the best of my ability. I may not be a topper or achiever or a gold medalist or a multi-millionaire or whatever it is, but I have done justice to it. So, peace within yourself comes from knowing where you are headed, to be able to identify your emotions, identify your value system. Why is it that I believe strongly in this? Is it only because of tradition, or is it because I actually believe in it today? The other is to be able to manage those emotions. Now that I have become super rich, have I become proud, for example? Have I become so proud of my achievement that I refuse to talk to my neighbors who remain poor people while I have become very rich? Going on to motivation, the changes in the motivation. That takes care of your first half of it, that is peace within yourself. Equally important, as I said, is harmony with others. Now, for harmony with others, you have to start first with that concept of empathy, which I keep on repeating is the most misunderstood aspect, like most puppies are misunderstood people. So, empathy is as misunderstood as all the other poor puppies. Just because empathy, like other puppies, does not speak much. You have to experience it, and then only you get to know what the empathy is. Simplest definition of empathy you know is putting yourself in the other person's shoes. Trying to think or trying to understand or trying to visualize what this other person must be going through. This person wants to make friends with me. Why does he want to make friends with me? Is he genuine or is he got some vested interest? So even again, that's what I come back to, even something nice. See, empathy is not restricted to crisis or sad situations or something of that sort. A person who can build this skill of empathy asks himself, yes, I'm basically a social person. I like human beings. I like meeting people and making friends. And here is this person who is making efforts to come closer to me or to befriend me. If I do not have empathy, what happens is, out of sympathy, I start becoming friends. See, he is taking the trouble. Poor chap. Even though I never visit his house, 6 times he has visited my house. So, he is a very genuine friend. That is sympathy, not empathy. Because somewhere along the line, he may be making those 6 visits because of some vested interest. He may have something else in his mind. Only if I have the skill of empathy, I will say, yes, I understand why this person is being so friendly with me. He has his reasons. I am not even going to put him down or suspect him or something. But I am not in congruence with it. I don't have to force myself. Just because he has visited my house 6 times, doesn't mean that I have to visit his house, or I have to give him a gift on New Year, or I have to call him for a dinner or something of that sort. This is where the empathy factor starts. So, you have to be able to put yourself in the other person's shoes. And what prevents us from putting ourselves in the other person's shoes many a time is because we don't remove our own shoes. We are all wearing shoes. When I say shoes, it is the shoes of the family that you are born in. The type of upbringing that you got. The type of value systems or ethics or morals that you were the type of religious rituals that you were made to believe in, the type of culture, food habits, dressing habits, anything and everything, we have very strong focus on our own self. And it's very, very clear that most of us unfortunately think that anybody who is different is wrong. And there has been a tremendous polarization, particularly in the last 10 years in the whole world, where we seem to have developed this concept of, if you are not with me, you are against me. You have to identify. This used to be a real problem only of school children, who used to form a gang and, one boy going to his group of three friends, they used to say, hey, we saw you talking to that tagil. So, you don't come into our group, you decide either you be friends with us or you be friends with Tamil. That's our thing which we used to grow out of. Today even nations have come to that level. No country is allowed to be neutral. You have to take a stand, otherwise you are against us. So, in many instances what has happened is that people start having this concept that you cannot remain neutral, you have to take a stand, etc. But if you have that skill of empathy, if you develop that skill of empathy, you will be able to understand and tell yourself, this is a reason why this person wants me to be part of his group, or wants me to befriend him, or wants me to treat him in a particular way, and now I will decide whether I want to oblige him or not, or to what extent I want to oblige, or under what circumstances I want to oblige him. So if I take that into account, I can do wonders. But that is what I want you to please keep in mind, that when you want to empathize with somebody, you have to start off with removing all your shoes of the way you think. And then only you will be able to come to some, logical or some really relevant understanding of how the other person thinks, that the other person's indoctrination, the other person's value systems, or whatever it may be. The fifth and last pillar of emotional intelligence is social skills, interpersonal skills. And that is, I think, the ultimate. Because the way technology is improving, we are going to have machines, computers, robots, gadgets, apps, as they say, to do anything and everything for us. So, as far as getting physical work done, whether it is a complicated maths problem or whether it is a perfect welding between two pieces of metal, all this will be done by machines. Maybe even assembling an entire car or an aircraft will be done by robots and machines, where you just feed in the necessary inputs and sit back and the aeroplane will roll out of the hangar. It's not far away. That is where we have heading. But there is a critical difference. The computers, machines and robots will obey any order that you give them. Human beings will not. You remember I had told you how much psychology I learned from truck drivers, by their slogans at the back of their trucks. And the one which has always stood out with me was this Haryana registration truck, behind which was written in Hindi, "Insaan ko apne dukh se utna dukh nahi hota, jitna dusre ke sukh se hota hai." A person doesn't feel sad because he is going through misery or whatever it is. He feels sad because the other person is doing well in life. Why is he not sad? Why I am only sad? And that in English is referred to as the why me syndrome. The moment something bad happens, I immediately ask, why me? Why should it happen to me? When it has not happened to my neighbor or my brother or my colleague or my whatever it is. Why should it happen to me? Whereas statistically, if you see, it happens to everybody. That is where we lose out. I'll never forget that tennis player who died of AIDS, long back, Arthur Ashe. He had given a very touching statement when people were asking him, you, such a great man and with such a great future and this and that, and now you've got HIV and AIDS and your life is coming to an end. And don't you question, what's happening to you? And he said, I used to, till I got part of one basic thing. There are probably, 5 million youngsters in the world who want to become tennis players. 4 million out of them never become tennis players. They don't have the facility.
only 1 million become. I was one of them. I never asked why me. Out of that 1 million, maybe only 100,000 actually go to becoming some club champions or something of that sort. 900,000 only play and drop off. I was one of those 100,000 and I never questioned why me. Out of that 10,000 go up to some state level or country level or make a name for themselves. I was one of those 10,000. 90,000 dropped out at the club level or whatever it is. I never asked why me. Out of that 1,000 come to the international arena. I was one of them. I never asked. Then you have the top 100 seed. I was one of them. I never asked why. I went on to becoming the number one and I never asked why. But when I get A's, I ask myself, why me? This is what is a quality which you need to develop. You should not wait for a crisis to occur and then have to work on this. The same way as a lot of people do with their physical health. Day in and day out, I come across these very, very high-flying executives who you ask them for anything and everything. Their one and only excuse is, I am so busy with my work, I have time for nothing. Till one fine day, the doctor catches hold of them and puts them in the OT and does that angiogram and angioplasty and something of that sort and warns him that if you don't lose 20 kgs and if you don't bring your cholesterol down and something, you had it. The next morning, our man has got 2 hours to go for a leisurely walk. He will give up the best of dinners in 5-star hotels and keep eating salad at home. He will do anything and everything. Now, this is the sad part, which again I feel is in some way connected to your emotional intelligence because you could not identify what is your motivator. Yes, when you were 20 years old, you had this great dream that I should be a millionaire or I should have a car or I should have my house or whatever it is. And that's why you decided, so what, I'm 25 years old, I can work 16 hours a day. But when you were 45 years old, what was making you work 16 hours a day? When you had a big bungalow, what made you think that I must have a bigger bungalow or 10 bungalows or whatever it is? So all this is part of the emotional intelligence. But coming back to the fifth point that I told you, that only if you can get work done by others, if you can relate to others, if you can build good relationships, then and then only you are going to be a successful person. Even if you have the first four pillars, but you miss out on the fifth one, you don't have the capacity, the practice, the ability to build relationships with people, good harmonious relationships. And for that, you have to be adaptable because every human being you meet is going to be different. You have 6 neighbors around your house, each one has a different approach to life. And you know, people with low EQ, what they say, the worst thing that you can do for this last pillar is to start grouping people together. All my neighbors are proud people. Why? Because one person is actually very proud. One person showed glimpses of proudness. The other 4, I didn't even talk to them thinking that all my neighbors are proud people. My in-laws are very, very gossipy people. Why? Because in my whole set of in-laws, there are 2 who always sit and gossip. There is 1 more who listens to their gossip. There are 10 more who are the same human beings as you are, but you tend to say, make a grouping and a label and say, my in-laws are all gossipy people. I don't believe in friendships. Friends always cheat you. How many friends cheated you? 1.5. Out of how many friends you had in all your life? 50. Good friends. 48.5 didn't cheat you, but you come to this conclusion. These are very, very clear indicators of low EQ. Once we understand this thing, we can move on to the handout that I have given you on developing emotional intelligence. What I have done here is given you 10 exercises or activities to do. First one, learn to label your feelings rather than commenting on incidents, people, etc. Second, understand the difference between thoughts and feelings. This should have been taught to you, if not in LKG, at least by UKG. But unfortunately, nobody teaches us even today. All it takes is a little awareness and a little more practice, and you can achieve that. Third is take more responsibility for your feelings. If I am angry, it is not because he shouted at me, it is because I could not tolerate his shouting. Take responsibility for your feelings. Use your feelings to help make decisions. The more you identify and say, I am very angry with this man, now how do I deal with him? So when you label your feeling, believe me how much it helps you to take the right decision about how to deal with situations in life. If you are not using the anger part of it, you only look at that and say, he shouted at me, therefore I am going to do this. That is where we lose out. Use feelings to set and achieve goals. How good is my motivation? If it is not good, then first let me build on motivation. What's the point in setting up goals? And that's one thing that we do with children inevitably. Anything and everything is, have you done your studies? Have you done your homework? See how many marks you got in these. Okay, so what if you got that cup in basketball? How much did you get in your maths test? Fine. Your intentions are very good and you do want that child to do well in life. But what I am saying is, what are you doing to motivate that child? The child says, what do I get out of studies? Whereas if I am good in basketball, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You ask him, he'll list down 20 wonderful things which happen when he is come. Feel energized and not angry. Seventh one is validate other people's feelings. What other people feel, validate them. He is angry, he is upset, he is jealous. I'm going to validate that. I'm not going to agree with it, but I'm going to accept that, yes, this person is jealous of me. He has his own reasons for doing that. Eighth is use feelings to help show respect for others. The more you learn to respect others, and again I'm repeating, you don't have to agree with others, you only have to respect their feelings. Ninth is to avoid advice, controlling, criticism and lecturing others. And lastly, the tenth one, avoid or mentally insulate yourself from people who invalidate or put you down. I will take you through a few minutes of this exercise after the tea break. I will just use this opportunity to complete one or two announcements. Try and make it I statements instead of you statements, and I will please label the name of that reading. And in the second one, I have even clarified, just by using the word feel, it doesn't mean that you are talking about feelings. I feel like hitting you. It is not a feeling. You know, I am using the word feel. Why do I feel like hitting you? Tell me. Because I am angry. So I feel very angry. I feel I cannot control my anger. And therefore, I feel like hitting you. The moment that thought process comes into you, that awakening comes into you, the chances of you are doing something impulsive or something unwanted reduce significantly. You will be amazed how it happens. In things like anger and all that, you know, elders have always told us, count to 10 or something of that sort. You know why they say that? Because the moment you start counting to 10, you start introspecting. Your, you know, brain immediately starts working. While you are saying 1, 2, 3, 4 mentally, you are also thinking that this person used a bad word against me or this person cheated me. What should I do? How should I do? Should I do this? So you become more aware of these things. So that is what these first 2 points deal with. And then the third, as I told you, is to take responsibility for your feelings. If you find yourself saying, that neighbor irritates me so much, why can't he behave himself?
properly and fed up with the fellow, you know, his behavior better than we go on and on. The focus is on the neighbor, the focus is not on the me. The focus should be on me. That is, I feel jealous. I feel extremely irritated. I feel, you know, very uncomfortable when that noise or that disturbance is going on. So the more I learn to manage my feelings, the easier it becomes to deal with anybody, not just that particular neighbor or that particular action of that person. You can always have that thing of being able to say, yes, making a noise is his prerogative. Since I am not an influential person and it's not a crime to make a noise, I can't report to the police station or I'm not a violent person to go and hit him or make him shut up. That is beyond my control. He will probably keep making a noise. But to get irritated or upset with that noise or not is entirely in my control. That is the skill that we need to develop.
Sorry? Doing what makes sense.
Yes, I'll tell you that.
No, I'll tell you what I'm saying.
Yeah, go ahead.
Like, I have this experience a lot because I walk a lot.
Yes.
I'm walking on the pavement.
Yes.
This guy picks up his motorcycle and puts it in front of me. Yeah. I just say, look here. I'm supposed to walk here. I want to go there. I said, that's your problem. Get on the road. I mean, okay, sometimes I think you have to react. I'm sorry. Okay.
The point is this. What I'm emphasizing upon. I agree with Mandi that, you know, there are times when if you keep quiet, you feel very upset. There are times when we feel that unless I give it to him, you know, I am allowing these people to take advantage. And I'll go back and feel miserable and I'll feel that, you know, what a coward I am that I gave up and walked the other side, etc. But what I am emphasizing upon is, each one of us, whether it's Mandi or me or you, I need to do an introspection. I want to walk every morning. I know that that is what I like, I enjoy, I want to have a nice pleasant walk. There are so many advantages of it. I live in the heart of Bangalore City. So I can't walk in the jungle or on the district. Can I walk in the park? There's no park close by or it's too crowded or whatever it is. So I have to walk on the road. Now once I've come to that conclusion, I have to label my feelings. See, one is, what happened when I had that argument with that motorcycle fellow? Next day, I don't have an argument and I move on. I need to check myself, I need to introspect and see which gave me more peace of mind, which made me feel better. And we are so individual that one person will come back and say, I felt better shouting at that fellow. Another person will say, I felt better when I didn't shout. That is where your emotional intelligence has to come in. There is no one answer which fits everybody. But the introspection part of it, that awareness part of it, I am feeling irritated, I am feeling angry and this. The other thing is, as Mandi already said, we need to do something. Sometimes, you know, people are taking advantage and going off board. The more my emotions are under control, generally, the better is the chance that I will do something long term about it. Maybe I can go and give a complaint to the police. Maybe I can write a letter to the editor of the newspaper. Maybe I can take a photograph and get it published somewhere or whatever it is. Now, when can you do that? When your emotions are under control. If I am the type who loses my temper and gets angry, every time I would like to stand there, see to it that fellow moves out of, you know, getting to an argument with him and all that. And by the time I am so exhausted and so fulfilled that I manage it. What did I manage? I managed to move one motorcycle. How many motorcycles do we have in Bangalore? Do you have an idea? 40 lakhs. So these are the nitty-gritty of the thing. Every time we need to stop and we need to think. And that again brings me to the fifth point. Use feelings to set and achieve goals. I have this goal of wanting to do this.
I'm going to use this feeling. I'm very angry, I'm very upset. It's not one day, 2 days. The last 6 months, almost every day I'm experiencing some stupid fellow or the other who's doing this, this, this. So I'm going to use that for a long term goal, which may also include packing up from Bangalore and going and living in the Himalayas. There's nothing to prevent me from doing that. Remember that. I have to tell myself I have the choice. I can go and live in a place where there is no motorcycle in the neck in 10 kilometers radius. But I choose to live in the city because I am a social being, because of these or that. Even that gives you a sense of little bit of satisfaction that I'm not being forced. I'm choosing to live in this place. Even in Bangalore, maybe I can go some 30 kilometers away, you have some gated community or some suburban this thing where I can walk on, or nobody else comes in with motorcycles or something of that sort. But why am I not doing that? Because I can't stay 30 kilometers outside the city. I have other work to do, I have other, you know, responsibilities or contacts or whatever it is. So again, I'm choosing. Within Bangalore also, I can go outside the city and stay in some suburban area. But I would like to be there.
In the same way, how can we put the positive emotion, like happiness, you said, right?
Yeah.
Like how that man wanted to say to his office about his car and...
That's right. I'm the person who got so thrilled when he bought his car that he felt like telling 100 people. Who are the people who will really enjoy this thing? I've got this childhood friend who is so connected to me, etc., etc., that I know even if I sit for half an hour and talk to him, he'll be very thrilled that I managed to buy a brand new car. But he's not available here today. He's still very far away. I can meet him only on Sunday. But that's where comes delayed gratification, another factor of emotional intelligence. People who know how to manage their emotions also know how to delay gratification. I am going to go across on Sunday. I am going to pick up this friend of mine, go and sit in one of the best restaurants which both of us like, enjoy some lovely snacks or lunch and all that. And I am going to talk 1 hour to him everything about the car, and I know that he will enjoy it and he'll feel proud of me. So there are always ways and means of doing it. And sixth one is that feel energized and not angry. That is where, you know, incidents like this. Our anger actually drains us in many cases, not always, but sometimes you will find that the anger actually drains you off. If you can manage your emotions, control your emotions, or give proper outlets to your emotions, you will see how your energy level goes up. Then comes seventh one, validate other people's feelings. Why did that fellow get angry with me when I told him that this footpath is meant for walking? Why did he get why did he say this nasty thing? Start from there. What he said. Was it because he was angry? Was it because he was in a hurry? Was it because he was frustrated? Was it because he was this?
He was too surprised to say anything. Just got up.
Okay. So why is it that he was so surprised that he moved up? Whatever may be the reaction. What I am saying is I need to validate what is happening. I told you about that incident of that, poor old lady who had just learnt driving, and she stopped at that signal and this fellow was doing pay from behind. So she went out with the keys and gave the keys to him and said, can you please try and start my car? In the meanwhile, I'll sit in your car and keep blowing the horn for her. That's another thing, please remember, sense of humor. Sense of humor is another very, very important barometer of your emotional intelligence. Next one, use feelings to help show respect for others. How will you feel if I do this? How will you feel if I don't do it? Take other people's feelings into consideration. And then, of course, I need not repeat this. Avoid advising, controlling, criticism, lecturing others. It's ridiculous. The great psychologist Dennis the Menace says, you know, why is it that whenever mom says we have to talk, it is only she who is doing the talking? So right from small children to your very elderly great-grandfather, nobody wants to be controlled or criticized or lectured or whatever it is. Inform the person once. always take the trouble of informing, never presume that he knows. If my grandfather every evening that I come starts off with in 1948 when I got my first job or something of that sort and I'm fed up of it, inform him. If other when I come back in the evening, I can't, I don't have the patience, I know you must have learned those very interesting things. And many a time you've shared it also with me, but if you keep repeating that, somehow I'm not in that position to do that, whatever, just explain to him. If he continues, after many days gap, again bring it to him. After he continues, then start the action part of it. Sorry, not right now, Tata, I have to go and have a bath, it's very hot at least, get up and walk. Or something else. Shall I get you a cup of tea? I also feel like having a tea. I'll go and get the tea, so he has to stop doing that. These are the ways that that means. And lastly, as I told you, avoid or mentally insulate yourself from people who invalidate or who put you down. It is not possible in many instances to physically insulate yourself. But every one of us can mentally insulate ourselves even from the closest of people who are there with you. Any time and anywhere it can be done. And you know that there are so many spouses who have practiced this so well that when the spouse is talking, the person just doesn't listen to whatever is So, if you want some private tension, there are people like that who will use that. But, jokes aside, it is definitely possible. You can mentally insulate yourself work towards it. And don't feel guilty. When you know that Tata has this habit of always talking about 50 years back and something of that sort, don't feel guilty after you've given him that initial listening. Give him an outlet, give him an opportunity to share. Whatever it is. But the moment you find him getting either repetitive or encroaching on your privacy or your time or saying things which hurt you, like he's converting that to say, you people don't have morals and values. When I started work, I was getting 180 rupees salary, but I never used to do that. You people get 1 lakh salary and you do it. So even if he's accusing you, if he's any of these circumstances you are faced with, and knowing that he is your close person and you can't physically insulate yourself, learn the technique of mentally insulating yourself from the person. Even children do that very beautifully. We lose that art which we have got. Mommy may be going on and on shouting, the child is actually playing with whatever he is. There was a lovely cartoon where this child, mother comes very angrily and says, put away your toys right now. In the second box, mother is even more angry and shouting louder and saying, how many times I have to tell you? Right now, come on, put away your toy. Third time she comes and she says, this is the last time I'm telling you, put away your toys. And the child turns around with a big grin and says, last time? That means you won't tell me again.